Hello, I'm Gwen Ifill. Welcome to the Washington Week Webcast Extra. I'm joined around the table by Indira Lakshmanana of Bloomberg News, Alexis Simendinger of Real Clear Politics, Pete Williams of NBC News, and Dan Baltz of The Washington Post. Why do we love politics? Let me count the ways. For one, there's always something new to talk about, like this. Former Arkansas governor and presidential candidate Mike Huckabee talking about why Republicans are the party that respects women.
That's not a war on them, it's a war for them. And if the Democrats want to insult the women of America by making them believe that they are helpless without Uncle Sugar coming in and providing for them a prescription each month for birth control because they cannot control their libido or their reproductive system without the help of the government, then so be it.
Indira went, oh, when she heard that. Okay, I want to ask you this, Dan. Uncle Sugar, my favorite thing. But let's move on to the libido question. Was he riffing? What was that about?
Had to be riffing. And he's a good riffer.
Yeah, normally.
But it ought to be like rule at least two or three, don't use the word libido.
Right after don't say mistakes were made.
Right. This has given the Democrats such an opening. I know there are a lot of Republicans who think the Democrats are seizing on this just to do it and that they say they're ignoring what he was really saying in the context of what he was trying to say. But it came out badly enough that the chairman of the Republican National Committee, Reince Priebus, gently reproached him on Friday for having said what he said, and reminding people that tone and words are important in politics and that we should all be mindful of that.
Well, especially in a party that's trying to rebuild its relationship with women, what was he trying to say? I mean, you say it didn't come out right, but what was he, take the word libido out of it, what was the overall point he was attempting to make?
I think what he was trying to say is that the Democrats are trying to buy the votes of women. By offering
free things.
And there's a debate about whether, you know, these should be included in the new health care law in all packages. But, any time in American politics in this day and age you start talking about birth control and in some way suggest there's something wrong with it, you're on very shaky
ground. Our women's bodies or choices, you have to be very careful. I want to ask you one other question. Put on your movie reviewer hat. There's this new Netflix documentary that takes you behind the scenes with Mitt Romney, and we haven't seen it yet around the table, but you have. It sounds very interesting. All I've seen is the clip where he seems to be ironing his suit while wearing it.
There is. He's in white tie. He's going to the Al Smith dinner, and there's a wrinkle on his cuff, and he's trying to do it, and he goes with the iron, and he'll go, ouch, ouch. Anyway. It's a wonderful
so much more real life.
This is a wonderful movie because it takes you places where you've never gone as a political reporter. It's basically the inside look, not about with the staff so much, but with Mitt Romney, Ann Romney, and the family as they talk through both the 2006 campaign and the 2008 campaign and the 2012 campaign. It starts with a scene in 2006. It is compelling.
Yeah.
You see a variety of different Romneys in there. You see a Romney with a lot of self-doubt. You see a Romney with some self-confidence. And there is a wonderful scene which both starts the movie and ends it, in which they're sitting in the suite at the hotel in Boston the night he loses the election, which he did not expect to lose. And he says to the assembled group in the room, what do we say in a concession speech?
And
it is just one of those moments.
You kind of wish as a reporter you were that.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Pete, let's go to another interesting, the guy who will never go away because every single week there's a new disclosure, and that's Edward Snowden. I was about to talk about Eric Holder, the attorney general, who was asked this week, is there a possibility of granting him clemency so he can come back to this country and finally, I don't know, tell us what he really did.
Right. And, of course, let's remember where this talk all comes from. John Miller from CBS is interviewing some folks at the NSA, one of whom says, some of us here at the NSA think it would be a good idea if the government were to say to Edward Snowden, stop the leaks, no more disclosures, and all is forgiven, come on home. That would be more in the national interest. So it's been out there. Now, the Attorney General's talked about it a little bit.
And the NSA guy did not rule it out. That's why it's...
Yes, and of course, he was the head of the NSA, General Keith Alexander, said he thought it was a terrible idea. But there was an interview with the president in the New Yorker magazine this week in which he was asked about it. And he said, I can't give a yes-no answer on clemency. So Ari Melber from MSNBC interviewed the Attorney General this week and said, can you basically, what about you? And he said, if you mean, all is forgiven kind of clemency, no, we're not going to do that. Now, the Attorney General went on to say, as in any criminal case, if he wants to come back here and face up to his responsibility, then sure, we'll talk to his lawyers about negotiating a plea as we would with any criminal defendant. But it was the most clear statement from the Attorney General that clemency, amnesty, all is forgiven is off the table.
And dear, I want to take you back to Iran for a moment, because we discovered this week that Iran has kept some of its promises about allowing inspectors in to look at its weapons production, nuclear weapons production.
Well, not weapons, the nuclear enrichment program.
Production. And as a result, they've been rewarded by the relaxing of some sanctions.
That's right.
So there's a big debate going on about whether these sanctions, any sanctions, should be relaxed against Iran. But there's a couple different sides to that question.
Right. Well, you're right. This is the beginning of the six-month deal. And what we have, you know, at the one moment, everyone can clap and say, amazing, a year ago I would have been laughed off of this round table if I had said we're going to have a deal with Iran. We now do have one.
We wouldn't have laughed. You would have lifted an eyebrow.
You would have taken a broom and swept me off. And in fact, this deal has happened. Iran has begun with the liquidation or the removal of its 20% enrichment, which the West fears could be used at a higher grade for bomb-grade fuel. And in return, the West has agreed to relax some sanctions. One story I wrote about this week, which I think is really interesting, is the whole idea that one of the key relaxations in the sanction regime, is that the United States has agreed, okay, for this six-month period, we're going to allow Iran's oil importers to import at current levels. They're not going to have further significant reductions, which is what the law says, so they can keep it at the same level. Well, here's an interesting thing. The forecasters have said that Brent oil prices are going to drop. So, in fact, Iran could, if it's exporting the same levels, end up making less money in the next six months than it had in the last, even though it's agreed to all of these restrictions on its program. So, you know, it's clearly going to try to take advantage of the other, relaxation and restrictions over petrochemical trade, auto trade, gold, et cetera. But one of the most interesting things to see when you look at American press versus Iranian press is that each side is trying to play to its domestic audience. So Obama said, very limited, very targeted sanctions relief, very, very small. And Rouhani on his side in Iran has said, huge sanctions relief. Everyone's going to be coming back. Business coming back for business.
In the case of the president, he's got a lot of members of Congress, of the Senate.
That's right.
He needs
59 right now trying to get that new sanctions bill passed.
Tuesday night, State of the Union speech. We're at the edge of our seats. Alexis, what do we expect?
You don't look on the edge.
I guess not.
Have you seen some State of the Union address?
I'm willing to be persuaded.
So this will be the president's beginning of his sixth year and second term, and we know that he's already lowered our expectations considerably by saying that this is not going to be a big legislative year, that he has a lot of holdover issues from last year because none of his major parts of his agenda went through with Congress. And the president's going to sort of sweep up some of the old and meld it together with the new. And one of the things that he said this week in an interview that we saw with The New Yorker was how important it was for him to be thinking about trying to do the best thing for Democrats. We're in a midterm year. He's interested in creating an agenda or painting a picture of an agenda that is going to be helpful to Democrats. So it's going to sound a little bit more on the progressive side than it would be on the centrist side.
Is that why we keep hearing about talk of income inequality as a
income theme? Inequality, although he might not describe it as that. He might talk about ladders of opportunity. You're still on the edge of your seat, aren't you?
I am. Ladders of opportunity.
Yes. And the minimum wage and unemployment insurance, which Harry Reid, the majority leader of the Senate, is going to try to bring back again this week as a bookend to the president's speech. And the president's obviously going to talk about a million other things, including international policy. But on the domestic, he wants still to get immigration. That's up to House Republicans, whether that moves forward. But in some ways, this is a president with very little juice. And he's going to be talking about his pen and his phone, which he, for some reason, keeps wanting to talk about as if he has the power of these P's.
The interesting thing about on both the ladders of opportunity and the immigration piece is that there are some Republicans he can appeal to on this somewhere in the middle, even if not on the solutions, at least on the problem.
On immigration, absolutely. Yeah. And he thinks that secretly House Speaker John Boehner is one of those and would like to be an ally in this because of the political desire to get this behind a Republican.
Well, I will be at the edge of my seat because I have to be sitting there that night with Judy Woodruff covering it. So I can't wait myself.
Okay.
That's it. That's all for now. Thank you, everybody. And we'll see you next time on the post-State of the Union Washington Week Webcast Extra.